The moment you want the truth, as badly as you just now wanted air, you'll find it. We can show you the truth, but you have to want it.
Show me. I want to know the truth.
You've got to see this incredible video of a tornado in Iraq, and that's a place where, you know, tornadoes are fairly rare, but this one, you've really just got to watch the progression of it. It starts off really not looking all that bad, a little bit of debris flying around, kind of small debris, but once it really starts to pick up the dust and dirt, then you can realize how violent it is. I mean, look at that. Look how fast the spinning is down at the bottom of that thing. Now, you're going to notice a transition here as the tornado progresses into kind of its later stages. It's going to change color from brown to white. Look at this. This is incredible. And you know what's actually happening there? The brown color is debris, that stuff we were just talking about. When you see the white there, that's actually just a condensation funnel. So it's almost the same thing as a cloud. Extremely high cloud base there, too. I mean, you don't usually see a cloud base that high with tornadoes. Oh, and by the way, there's another one right next to it, too. One of the rare videos where filming it vertically actually worked out really well.
spike in earthquake activity has scientists paying close attention to Mount St. Helens. We want to know if this means we're headed towards another eruption. We sent Trevor Ault to find out.
Since the massive eruption in 1980, scientists with the Cascades Volcano Observatory have been keeping a really close eye on Mount St. Helens. And today they told me that some new numbers indicate we might be heading down a similar path to another eruption.
This is a form of early warning.
Seth Moran has been studying Mount St. Helens for nearly 30 years.
St. Helens has a geologic pattern of blowing itself apart and then building itself back up.
Moran and his team of scientists say they've noticed an uptick in earthquake swarms happening beneath the volcano. It's now up to nearly 40 small earthquakes per week.
We've seen a couple of signs and symptoms since then that have indicated to us that small amounts of magma have been coming in.
Moran tells me he knows where this pattern is headed.
It's telling us that years to decades from now, St. Helens will erupt again.
That May 18th, 1980 eruption killed 57 people and resulted in more than $1 billion in damage. Moran assured me that the next eruption won't be nearly as devastating.
Our best forecast, long-term forecast, is that the next eruption will be a lava dome building eruption. We'll have some explosivity to it, but nothing as catastrophic as St. Helens as 1980.
Even so, I wanted to make sure the Northwest has nothing to worry about.
Do people need to be concerned about this?
No. It's a collective heads up that St. Helens is getting ready to go again, but it's years, decades down the road.
A wave of small earthquakes shaking Mount St. Helens in recent days, and experts say more than 100 quakes have actually occurred underneath the Washington State volcano over the last several weeks. So what does this volcanic recharge mean? Let's bring in meteorologist Allison Chinchar. She is in our CNN Atlanta Weather Center. Allison, this seems a little bit fishy, to say the least, a little nerve-wracking for folks in that zone.
That's right. When you say hundreds of them, you think, oh, these must be big quakes. But that's just it. These have been incredibly small quakes. However, it's the frequency of them that has scientists kind of keeping a close eye on this. So this is the area over the past 7 days. These blue squares that you see, those are the monitoring sites that they have out there. And then all of these dots, these are all of the earthquakes that have occurred in this region in the last 7 days. Now, again, I want to point out, none of these have been huge. In fact, most of them have been at a magnitude of 0.5 or less. You and I can't even detect that. They're so small. Now, the maximum was around a 1.3. Again, very hard for humans to detect something of that small magnitude. Now, they all were very shallow, between about 1.2 to 4 miles in depth. Now, basically what this means is when you get these swarms, it's the repressurization of the magma that's in there, and it kind of sifts through some of the cracks that are there. And that's what causes a lot of these little mini earthquakes. But you want to keep in mind, this process can continue for years without an eruption. And that's what the experts are trying to make sure that people understand. They're not tossing any anomalous gases come out, and they're not expecting an imminent eruption by any means. So again, sounds cool, sounds interesting, but not really a big threat at this time.
Well, we're learning more this morning about why earthquakes in the country's midsection could be as dangerous as in California and Alaska. Oklahoma, of all places, is being rattled by unprecedented surge in earthquakes. Two new small quakes hit just overnight. The state last year averaged more than two every day at magnitude 3 or higher. Before 2009, Oklahoma averaged two earthquakes a year. On Sunday, 60 Minutes' Bill Whitaker investigates why Oklahoma is an earthquake hotspot.
The vast majority of earthquakes are small, causing little or no damage. But what they lack in punch, they make up in sheer volume. This tally from the U.S. Geological Survey shows the number of earthquakes in Oklahoma has increased every year since 2009, with more than 2,000 magnitude 3 and above.
Oh.
That means more of the bigger ones, like this 4.3 magnitude quake last December in Edmond, Oklahoma.
I woke up scared to death, praying that the house wouldn't fall down. I couldn't believe that the windows didn't shatter.
Melinda Olbert and Kathy Matthews are neighbors in Edmond.
What quake app do you use?
I use the one.
They say they check their phone apps to track earthquakes around the state all day long.
So look at that.
Cherokee, Enid, Fairview, Medford, Stillwater.
All in one day.
Mm-hmm. All in one 24-hour period. 1 hour ago, 2 hours ago, 4 hours ago.
This must be unnerving.
It's no way to live. It's no way to live.
Cornell University seismologist Katie Karenin, was teaching in Oklahoma when the increase in quakes began. She says the situation is unprecedented.
What's going on here in Oklahoma has never been seen before?
Just the number of earthquakes is astounding, but how fast it grew is perhaps even more astounding.
Phil Whitaker joins us at the table. I hear the state, Oklahoma, I want to break out into the musical. So you don't think earthquake. So what's happening here, Bill Whitaker?
Well, scientists have come to the agreement that these earthquakes, the spike in earthquakes, is actually man-made. Mm. That they're being triggered by Oklahoma's number one industry, oil and gas. And it's from the disposal of billions and billions of gallons of wastewater. Now that water is down there with the oil. It's been there for millions of years. But now they're pumping up more oil, they're getting more of this water, and they have to get rid of it somehow. So they put it back underground. The problem is that the water is now seeping into the earthquake fault zone, and the water pressure is pushing those faults apart, letting them slip and slide, and causing more earthquakes.
So far, these are originally small earthquakes.
They're fairly small by, you know, when you're talking about magnitude. But as you said in the intro, they've had almost 1,000 magnitude 3 and higher last year, which is unprecedented. The highest one was 5.7, and having lived in California, that's a pretty good jolt.
Yeah. Having lived in California myself, is there a difference in the impact of these quakes as opposed to the ones we see out west?
Well, you know, we all grew up thinking of California as the earthquake state. California is going to have to pass that dubious prize off to Oklahoma, because Oklahoma is now seeing more than California. And the difference in Oklahoma is that the earthquakes are at they're closer to the surface, so the magnitude might not be that dramatic, but the impact is dramatic.
Greek labor unions have begun a 48-hour nationwide strike in protest over further austerity measures, including new pension cuts and tax increases. The government has proposed a measure with goals to get more bailout money to repay its debts. The proposed legislation would raise social security contributions, increase income tax for high earners, and introduce a new national pension. The strike was called by the largest private and public sector unions and had paralyzed the traffic and basic infrastructure productions. The proposed measures are due to be voted on in Parliament on Sunday.
You should take back these measures. These are not things that a supposedly left-wing government does.
We are in a situation where national wealth has gotten smaller. We are one-fourth poorer than we were in 2010, and we have to distribute a smaller piece of the pension pie. But for the first time, it will be in a fair way. What does fair mean? Equal terms for all. Not like the old political system where the future generation was paying the bill.
Trump, it's like him running for president is like a college kid trying to get a job after college. That's what it's reminding me of. He has no experience. I don't trust him. Everything that he said, he made fun of a disabled reporter. He has made sexist remarks. He's made Islamophobic remarks.
I just want him to know that he's not welcome here, and that we have a lot of people that do not support him, do not support his racist rhetoric, and that, you know, we're here in solidarity together of people who are Mexican, Mexican-American, Muslim, just everyone in general, Asian-American, Asians. We all just want to come together and tell him that he's not welcome here and that love will always win.
I like a lot of his stances on different things, like especially the trade deals. I definitely think there's a problem with illegal immigration, and I think the wall should be built. I also think that the alternative is Hillary Clinton, and that's just more of the same kind of going on. And she's really corrupt, and she's just been in the system too long, and we need new blood.
Down with Trump! I want to see the hammer!
roadway for vehicular and pedestrian traffic. Thank you.
Inside the event, our cameras caught a small scuffle as hundreds of Trump protesters gathered. Organizers said they did not want to break any laws or disrupt traffic, but the crowd spilled out onto the street outside the event center. Protesters stayed throughout Trump's speech, chanting, but there were no major incidents to report. Organizers say they had a bigger turnout than expected because Trump's weekend stop in Vancouver was canceled.
Keep hate out of our state. Trump's rhetoric is nothing new. This is something that, you know, has been in place for several years, and it's still a reality we are facing here today, even in a blue state like Oregon.
Now, we checked. There were no arrests connected to Trump's visit. Now, Trump has two planned appearances tomorrow in Washington state.
Education leaders laying out guidelines for transgender students.
So this outlines everything from the name and pronouns that a student uses to bathrooms, of course, and school sports. It's designed to protect children, but some say the guidelines go too far. Amy Frazier digging deeper.
Jeff, according to the guidelines, if, for example, a student identifies as a female, that student should be able to participate in female sports and activities. Supporters say it's a step in the right direction. Opponents argue the guidelines are out of line.
This is the Oregon Department of Education's 15-page document called Guidance to School Districts, Creating a Safe and Supportive School Environment for Transgender Students. The state says it developed the guidelines to provide assistance for districts to foster an educational environment that is safe, free from discrimination, and aligned with state and federal laws. I met with Andrea Zekas with Basic Rights Oregon.
Students should be able to participate and feel like that they belong in school. And that's what the issue is here. They should be able to have full participation.
The guidelines say a student who says she is a girl and wishes to be regarded that way should be respected and treated like any other girl. The same goes for a student who says he is a boy. The guidelines also say transgender students should be allowed to change their name. As far as bathrooms and locker rooms, it says students can request alternative accommodations such as a unisex bathroom. But it shouldn't be forced upon students or the only option, so they could use the bathroom that aligns with their gender identity.
I think it's great. Yeah. Yeah, I fully support it.
I mean, I'm a hardcore conservative, and I think that stuff stinks. Why the hell would you want to do that?
I just think it's very complicated, and I'm not sure how school districts should handle that.
The guidelines also say students should be permitted to participate in physical education and sports in accordance with the student's gender identity.
If that's where your ability level is at, then go for it.
I don't know. I just don't believe in that. I think whatever you're born with, you should stay with.
Tonight, we've posted the guidelines for you to read and decide for yourself how you feel at COIN.com. Reporting live in the newsroom, Amy Frazier, COIN 6 News.
Wow.
investigators searching for what sparked this raging inferno. Flames shooting out of a giant circular stained glass window.
I can't believe it's actually happening.
Parishioners crying and hugging, watching the building burn.
There's still no word on what caused a massive fire that destroyed a church in Chelsea. The historic building went up in flames yesterday, just hours after Orthodox Easter services.
In a strange twist, there were three major Orthodox church fires in three different cities worldwide, all of them around their Easter holiday. Investigators say no direct link as of yet. It could just be an odd coincidence.
Melbourne's oldest Greek Orthodox church has been damaged by fire. Hundreds of workers were evacuated from nearby office buildings as the flames took hold.
Plumes of thick black smoke billowed from the historic church. Flames shattered stained glass windows, terrifying onlookers. As the blaze took hold around 1:30 this afternoon.
One of the other windows kind of blew out and flames came out.
Fire investigators are still working to determine a cause, and such is the case in Sydney after a Macedonian Orthodox Church also went up in flames.
A weasel is suspected of chewing through a wire in one of science's most impressive machines. The Large Hadron Collider is the largest particle accelerator in the world. Pretty impressive when you think about it. The little critter apparently disabled a machine made up of close to 17 miles of superconducting magnets.
Hasty exit. That might have been the last time. Might have been the last time I ever saw my house right there.
This is insane. Holy. Boy, you can feel the heat. Holy shit. This is fucking crazy.
It's being called the largest evacuation in the history of Alberta, Canada. The entire city of Fort McMurray has been ordered to evacuate from a massive fire.
Plumes can be seen from space, traveling 3,000 miles all the way to Florida. Lightning may have sparked this blaze.
The whole place is being evacuated after a dramatic shift in the wind.
Parts of Alberta are literally hell on earth. 49 fires are raging, at least 7 burning out of control.
It's like Armageddon here. There's nobody on the road, nothing. Absolutely nobody.
Cars are burnt. There's people on the side of the road with crying babies and dogs and broken cars and no gas and no food. And it's like it's in a movie. I've never seen anything like this in my life.
All Albertans are watching this. All Albertans are with the people at Fort McMurray.
The end of days. Literally.
Firefighters call it the beast.
This is an extreme, rare fire event, and that's something that's historic for us.
The mood in the city is very, very somber. As we were pulling out, it felt like one of those Armageddon movies. The downtown was, you know, nobody there, no lights on, very dark gray skies, billowing smoke, and flames literally beside the road on both sides.
This is what we're seeing, and, you know,
I can't believe, first of all, there's been no injuries.
A packed parking lot in one of the largest evacuation centers in all of Alberta, the Expo Center here in Edmonton, where story after story is being told about people fleeing the flames.
It was something out of an apocalyptic movie or something.
The price of oil rose worldwide because of the catastrophe in Canada's oil sands region.
Welcome back to News 410. Dropping off babies in what's basically a drop box. That's the new program in place in Indiana through the state's Safe Haven Law. That law allows mothers to give up their newborns without prosecution. The boxes in firehouses are a little bit bigger than a microwave and have alarms to let first responders know there's a newborn inside.
These boxes are placed in a relatively private area to where mothers can safely surrender them.
Controversy this morning surrounding Disney's much-anticipated Frozen 2. There's now an online push to make a big change to one of the stars. Some Frozen fans want Disney to give Elsa a girlfriend in the upcoming sequel. This is all in an effort to raise LGBT awareness.
Let it go, let it go.
Could Disney let its writers go ahead and make Elsa a lesbian for the sequel of Frozen? The hashtag Give Elsa a Girlfriend has gone viral. A teen tweeted that out last month and basically said it'd be iconic if it happened. Mixed feelings online, of course. We'll just have to wait and see what Disney decides.
Caitlyn Jenner is about to bear quite a bit for Sports Illustrated.
And Crystal Cruz is here with today's Eye on Entertainment. You know, she turned some heads with that Vanity Fair cover last year. Well, this one possibly going to do the same. The former track and field star will pose for the cover of Sports Illustrated wearing very little. According to Us magazine, Jenner plans on wearing only an American flag and her Olympic medal to celebrate the 40th anniversary of her win. Jenner.
The North American bison, the buffalo, was one step closer to becoming the national mammal of the United States, all thanks to a bill that recently passed the U.S. House. It is expected that the Senate will adopt the House bill soon and then to President Obama for his signature. South Dakota Representative Kristi Noem was one of many who were instrumental in championing the National Bison Legacy Act, which will make the buffalo one of three official symbols of the U.S.
Buffalo is an iconic species in this country. You know, you have the bald eagle, which is recognized as a symbol. It's very deserving.
A courtroom outburst from the man who admits to killing three people at a Colorado Springs Planned Parenthood. Robert Deer was in court today so a judge could decide if he is mentally competent to stand trial.
And today, a similar scene. Deer interrupted the hearing several times, claiming he wanted to represent himself, playing into psychologists' arguments that he's delusional. Here's why Deer says he committed those murders. He believed the FBI has been following him for more than two decades and they wanted to kill him. And he wanted to make his last stand at the most evil place he could think of, which was the clinic. He also told officers he was trying to save unborn babies and he believes President Barack Obama is the Antichrist.
Now, when this hearing continues May 10th, one of the
County police say a suspect claimed he was God as he stole a BMW that he had taken for a test drive, where employees say they noticed some other odd things about the man.
Yeah, for starters, they say he walked onto this lot. He didn't arrive in a car, and this is the fancy sedan he wanted to test drive. Cops say 33-year-old Balan Oteo tried to steal the white sedan last Sunday during a test drive. Investigators say he told the salesman he was God and ordered him out of the car.
Thank you. Thanks for watching. Now, we've been looking into the concerns surrounding that large fault or crack that's in the ground that recently opened up near and behind that shopping center.
Well, Carolyn, if you take a look at the large crack in the ground behind me, you can see that a series of power lines actually runs along the base of the mountain here. So depending on how the ground shifts, we could have an even bigger problem here.
The officer told us he heard the crack grows further apart by 2 inches every day.
What caused a mass fish kill in a lake in Haikou City in South China's Hainan Province?
The Pacific beaches of Chile look more like graveyards these days, as piles of dead marine animals have washed ashore in recent months. It's being blamed on this year's El Niño, a weather phenomenon so powerful, the U.S. National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration called it El Niño Godzilla. El Niño causes warmer sea surface temperatures, which can lead to more algae, which consumes the oxygen in the water. Officials say a surge in algae earlier this year, known as a red tide, choked about 40,000 tons of salmon to death in the Los Lagos region.
Columbia County now, it's a stench that can be smelled blocks away. Hundreds of dead fish washed ashore at Lake DeSoto in Lake City. People who use the lake are shocked and want to know what's killing the fish. We got phone calls, emails, and people sent photos of what was happening.
Yeah, it's just a lack of oxygen. I tried to tell some people that around here, but they said that they're just not buying that. But that's what FWC, Florida Fish and Wildlife, says caused at least 200 fish to float to the top and even come ashore, creating a stench that you just couldn't ignore.
You could smell the rancid toxins of dead fish going back all the way to Madison Street.
It smelled like somebody just opened up a can of tuna in the middle of the lake, and like a huge can of tuna. It was really bad.
Cal Green is one of the people who called News 4 Jax and sent these pictures showing dead fish on the shore of Lake DeSoto. It's a place enjoyed by families.
In Lake City, it's such a small area, there's not a lot of things for families to do. So when something like this happens in the community to something everybody enjoys going to, it's really shocking.
More than 500 white bass have been found dead or dying at Lake Thunderbird. They're washing up on the southern shore of the lake. Fishermen actually first spotting the problem, a problem that appears to be all natural.
It is something you've likely seen in the movies.
Yeah, but it's also happening in real life. People are getting chips implanted in their hands and other places. Some people in the Twin Cities are embracing the extra personal technology that is turning them into human remote controls.
I can carry nearly 80 gigs of data in my head. 160 if I use a double. A computer!
Where'd you learn to do that?
Set in the far-off year of 2021, this is the 1995 film, Johnny Mnemonic.
I need a Sinologic 60.
Password.
One of several films that caught the attention of a boy growing up in Ridgefield.
There are so many limitations and conditions that we have as people that we can overcome if we put a little energy into it and a little technology.
The chip in his wrist clears his daily path.
So that unlocks my door.
Operates his computer and phone.
And it turned off my ringer.
And if he has his way, it will do much more.
God will bring every deed into judgment, Ben Judah, including every hidden thing, whether it is good or evil. I, the Lord, search the heart, I test the mind, and I will give every man according to his ways and according to the things he has done.
By the deeds of the law, no flesh shall be justified in his sight. For by grace you are saved, through faith. This is not for yourselves. Is the gift of God.
Be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God.
For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, to save the world through him. He who believes in the Son is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God.
Repent. Jesus is coming.
Don't throw your life away. Give it to Jesus while there's still time, please.
And he will hold us accountable. Time is running out. And I don't want you to go to hell. You've sinned against God, like I have. He calls us to love and obey him in everything we do. What we do in front of people, what we do in secret. Even down to what we think. God loves you. 2,000 years ago, he proved that. God became a man, Jesus Christ, and he suffered and died on the cross to save you. He literally died to take your punishment and my punishment upon himself so that we could be forgiven and set free. When Jesus rose from the dead and he ascended to heaven, he defeated death and hell, and he's offering you and I eternal life. God can do anything. If you are willing, God can save you. Confess your sins and turn away from them. And put your faith in Jesus Christ.
Jesus, if it's not too late, forgive me for my sins.
Jesus is King. Jesus is King. He is Lord forever.